¿Qué es la una pieza? La pregunta que todos nos hacemos, pero que nadie encuentra respuesta, que nadie la tiene salvo ese pibe. Goda lo hizo de nuevo. Procedemos a reaccionar a la teoría definitiva. Lo pone el pibe en el título, así que tiene que ser verdad. Pero, como os he comentado antes, respetada y valorada muchísimo por gente de la comunidad. Todo el mundo, pues, te lleva la teoría de Arthur, que hizo una serie de vídeos de toda la puta serie, pero que este es el último, el definitivo. Y que supuestamente responde a la pregunta de qué es el One Piece y cuál será, supongo, el final de la serie de Eiichiro Oda. Así que vamos a echarle un vistazo. Es una hora entera por delante, pero disfrutemos. ¿Te imaginas después de una hora entramando una cosa espectacular, en los últimos 10 segundos sean, por lo tanto, el One Piece será definitivamente, sin ningún tipo de dudas, los amigos que hicimos por el camino? Yo voy a decir ya mi teoría, ya la dije una vez, es un clip muy valorado de este canal, un clip que se compartió bastante en redes sociales y demás, pero la repito porque ese clip se perdió cuando tuve que borrar todo el tema. Antes de ver la teoría, porque no quiero que digáis que me ha influido en algún sentido o que he podido ver el vídeo y que he llegado a esa respuesta, mi teoría es, y sigo manteniéndola a día de hoy, que el One Piece es, pues bueno, acaban con todas las islas que sean, llegan a la última, Raftel, la que sea, la última Laugh Tale, la que sea, ¿vale? Llegan a la última isla, pues bueno, una X en un mapa, lo típico de piratas, excavan un cofre, puta madre, abren el cofre y dentro del cofre hay una nota que pone: felicidades, has leído todo One Piece sin pagar un duro, amigo. Tú eres el verdadero pirata. Se cierra el telón y Luffy hace así a cámara, hace así. Y termina One Piece. Esa es la teoría que yo sostengo desde hace un montón de años, desde 2017 creo que es este clip. Y ahora viendo la teoría de Arthur, igual llega a la misma conclusión que yo, ¿vale? Yo lo voy adelantando que igual mi teoría es de las más acertadas.
What is the One Piece? This is without a doubt the biggest mystery in the history of this manga, perhaps one of the biggest mysteries in the history of fiction. Despite being the title of one of the best-selling literary franchises of all time, the answer to what One Piece actually means still remains unanswered. In all its years of publication, no one has been able to uncover what the One Piece is. But I would actually argue the complete opposite. Because I believe that I know what the One Piece is. But at the same time, I also believe that you know what the One Piece is. That we all know what it is. I believe that every single person who has ever read One Piece, even if they've only read a single chapter, already know what the treasure is. Because ever since chapter 1, the very beginning of the series, Oda hid the treasure right under our noses, despite no one noticing in all these years of publication. Across the entirety of One Piece, across some of the most iconic and memorable scenes in the series, Oda has shown it time and time again, and yet without the proper context, you would have never guessed what it really is. So by the end of this, not only will I prove to you what I believe is the true identity of the One Piece treasure, show you how it's been hidden in plain sight across some of the most iconic and memorable scenes in the whole series, and how it ties with some of the most fundamental narrative themes of One Piece, but also how Eiichiro Oda has managed to hide the greatest mystery in the history of manga without a single person noticing right under our very eyes. This is the big...
La felicidad. La libertad. Momentos que compartimos durante el momento. Durante el camino. Felicidad.
Biggest and grandest One Piece theory ever created. One that took over 5 years to create. My magnum opus. This is the conclusion of the true history. The ultimate theory about the identity of the One Piece.
David, gracias por 10 meses, man.
This video serves as the culmination of several episodes I've done tackling each of the main topics that will help motivate this theory. If you are interested in some of the elements I'll discuss in this theory, I recommend you watch the other videos after, since they go a lot more in depth about some of these bigger narrative aspects of the story that I can't fully explain in this video. You can find them all linked in the description, but don't worry, as you don't need to watch them to understand this video, as I'll be giving you a quick summary of all the important things we managed to establish about the history of the One Piece world, which will serve as evidence to explain what I believe the One Piece is. So our entire search revolves around this treasure known as One Piece. And as Roger indicated, this treasure was left behind by an individual called Joy Boy. I believe that much like Roger and Luffy, Joy Boy was also a pirate who once set out to sea in search of adventure. And across his many travels, he grew in fame and power, eventually attaining a position of Pirate King. This title might have been bestowed to him because Joy Boy had founded a great kingdom of immense proportions, but the immensity of this kingdom might not refer to actual physical surface, but rather by the fact that said kingdom was not limited to the confines of its home island. Countless people from all across the world were part of this kingdom, being all those who Joy Boy befriended across his travels. In a sense, you could argue that perhaps this was less of a kingdom, and more simply like an enormous pirate crew. We know this by the fact that the Great Kingdom boasted allies from all corners of the world, from the Wano country, to the Minks, the Fishmen, the Shandorians, and many more. But the most important thing to note about Joy Boy's allies is that they were all from different races. Minks, Sea Folk, Sky Folk, Kuja, Giants, all different from the vast majority that ruled the world. Humans. And because of this diversity, the world was plagued by a disastrous problem. Racism and discrimination. For example, it's been mentioned that the fishermen...
El One Piece es racismo. Claro. Explicaría muchas cosas, la verdad. Explicaría muchas cosas, la verdad. Ha estado... Claro, tío, ha estado delante de mí todo este tiempo. El racismo. Por eso se ríe. Claro, tío. Es la N-word. ¿Te imaginas? Roger abre el cofre y es una nota con la N-word. Claro, pues es racismo. Racismo sí puede.
Were once driven out of the surface to the ocean floor by humans as an act of discrimination, or how we've seen the Tontata were hunted and persecuted even before the start of the Void Century, indicating this was an issue that stretched back for centuries. Because humans had the superiority in numbers, these races were persecuted, which led to discrimination and even enslavement, something that we can see in no better example than the King Don Quixote of ancient times enslaving the entirety of the tribe for the wealth of Dressrosa. And this went beyond just other races, because even humans oppressed themselves,
España.
With the privileged ruling from the top. On the other hand, however, you had someone like Joy Boy, someone who, thanks to his travels and broadening his horizons, came to become friend and ally to many of the world's races, and his ideals of freedom as a pirate made him yearn for a world where all people could be equal and free. And that was Joy Boy's ultimate goal, to bring and unite the whole world together, to turn the current corrupt system of the world upside down, bring an end to discrimination and slavery, and allow all to be free. Joy Boy's goal, in simple terms, was to allow all species to live under the same sun. The same goal that would be inherited by the descendants of the Sea Folk, and particularly Queen Otohime. The sun symbolizes the union of all races being able to live together, as well as joy, happiness, and laughter, and so Joy Boy made the sun his symbol. This is why the sun is featured across the emblems of so many of Joy Boy's allied kingdoms, and why Joy Boy himself came to be called by some people as the Sun God, he who would free all slaves and those discriminated from oppression by bringing them laughter.
Libertad.
Joy Boy would call this ultimate plan of his the dawn of the world, the day when the sun would rise, or, put it quite simply, the Romance Dawn. The dawn of adventure. And the way that he wanted to achieve that was by quite literally uniting the entire world together. He wanted to destroy the Red Line and the Grand Line to fuse all the seas together into the All Blue, a sea that had been lost to time and became nothing more than a legend ever since the world became divided. It is for this exact purpose that Joy Boy wanted to use the ancient weapons, because just like we are told in the story, the weapons will eventually bring the destruction of the world. But this is not a destruction meant in a negative sense, but rather
claro.
as a way to destroy the barriers that were dividing people, stopping them from being free
destruir
and
el mundo
able
que conocemos
the world.
Well,
we
mundo
can't
dividido.
Fully discern the identity of two of the weapons. We already know how Poseidon operates, being able to command the enormous species known as Sea Kings. Because of that, Poseidon would be instrumental in undoing the calm belts where the Sea Kings reside, thus being able to undo the Grand Line. And when one of the other weapons would destroy the Red Line, then Poseidon would be needed to lift the Ark Noah, which all the citizens of Fisherman Island could board to be emigrated to the surface. While the remains of the Red Line falling down would crush and destroy Fisherman Island, just like Charlie prophesied a man wearing a straw hat would one day help bring. However, it seems that Joy Boy was not able to accomplish this. It is possible that the Mermaid Princess of that time perished during the conflict against the 20 allied nations of humans opposed to Joy Boy's ideals, hence why he wrote an apology letter in her name, and thus the destruction of the world leading to its union could not happen. And we know for a fact that the weapon Poseidon is only reborn every several hundred years, the exact same term that has always been used to refer to the distance of time between the void century and the present. In other words, Poseidon is only reborn every 800 years, which means that Joy Boy and his people would have to wait 800 years all the way to present day in the story for Poseidon to reappear, and for someone, a new Joy Boy, to appear and guide the ancient weapons to destroying the world so it could be reborn anew in a unified form, just as it is told in prophecies of old. A long night would set where the allied nations, now forming as the world government, would hold an iron grip over the world. But once that night would be over, the D would bring a massive storm that would shake the entire world, which could quite literally be an actual storm, considering a certain prominent D member has the ability to create storms with his powers. But once that storm would be over, finally, at last, the sun would rise again, leading to the dawn of the world, to a new beginning. And in order to ensure that one day a new Joy Boy would appear, he made sure that his will would one day be inherited. For that we need to...
Pero hace tantísimo que estaba Joy Boy, en plan 800 años han pasado para que Luffy sea ahora The Chosen One. Hay tanta diferencia. Sí. Hostia, 800 años es mucho tiempo, en verdad. Han pasado varias generaciones, pero 800 años son literalmente 8, 9, 10 generaciones. Nadie, gracias por decirme será dos a más. Muchas gracias, man.
Understand what inherited will means, but it's quite simple because Dr. Hiraluk already told us exactly what inherited will is. That people only die when they are forgotten. So in our words, if someone isn't forgotten, their will, their own dreams live on, just like they did for Hiraluk. And in a similar regard, Joy Boy's dream would be passed down, both through the Poneglyphs and individuals inheriting his dream generation through generation. The world government tried to stop this dream from being inherited, which is why they purged all information from the Void Century, in an attempt that Joy Boy would be forgotten, and thus, just as Hiraluk put it, that he would die with his dream being forgotten. Because just as Clover said, the world government was most afraid of Joy Boy's dream and ideals. And yet...
Hostia, tiene todo el puto sentido eso, en verdad, ¿eh? Claro, si intenta proteger tantísimo del siglo vacío, porque lo que no quieres es que se revivan esos ideales de destruir el mundo, no en un esto negativo, sino de eliminar un poco las diferencias y las limitaciones que hay en todos y cada uno de los océanos. Y que todo ese sistema se derrumbe a nivel espectacular. Nah, Goda lo hizo de nuevo, ¿eh?
Yet his dream was inherited across the ages, from person to person, until it was inherited by Gall D. Roger, and later, of course, Monkey D. Luffy. The exact same dream that they both declared in front of others, and left them completely dumbfounded. The dream to throw the biggest party in the world. I think that Joy Boy's dream, beyond destroying the Red Line and the Grand Line and unifying the world, was to throw the biggest party anyone could imagine.
Siempre festejan, en verdad, al final de un arco, ¿eh? Siempre se ponen ahí súper horny, súper borrachos y se divierten que
flipas. So to unite the hearts of souls of people, Joy Boy wanted to throw a massive party that could connect and unite everybody in the world. We've seen how a party like the one at the
NSK que el mundo sea una sola pieza. One Piece, que el mundo sea una sola pieza. Locurote. Cómo te rompe la mente eso, ¿eh?
A 400-year-long war, so one big enough to invite everybody from all across the world could quite possibly bring an end to all conflicts for good. In the end, Joy Boy wanted to connect the world together, to toss away suffering and sadness, and instead exchange it with joy and laughter, hence why he came to be known as the Joy Boy, for his goal was to bring joy to all those in the world, all through the act of a massive party where everyone could laugh together. But since Joy Boy could not unite the world together, and would have to wait 800 years since someone could guide the weapons to do so, he had to give up on that party until then. So in order that someone could one day pull off that massive party, he left behind a treasure. A treasure that could be used after the ancient weapons unify the world to connect all its people together. A treasure that could quite literally connect the world as one piece. But what treasure could be so special to bring everyone together and make such a massive party of reality? That's exactly what we're here to find out. We could speculate and try to guess what it is, but instead I suggest that we bring together the remaining puzzle pieces to finally solve this eternal riddle once and for all. Oda may not have left that many clues to the identity of the treasure, but the few he left behind will be enough for us to connect all dots together. Let us see exactly what these clues are all about. Our first clue lies at the very beginning of the series, on the very first page in fact, being the final words that Roger uttered. My treasure, if you want it, it can be yours. I left everything in this world at that place. This might not seem important at first, but the more you think about it, the more you start to realize how everything in this world is actually far more than just a fake statement. But there is another very important scene later in the series that uses this exact same term to tell us what everything in the world really means. Because it's during one of the most important scenes in the series where the meaning of these words becomes a lot clearer. When Roger laughed. As Odin indicated in his journal, on that day, we reached the final island. We learned everything in this world. This would indicate that everything in the world refers in a sense to the truth of the world, because it encompasses everything one would like to know about everything there is in the world. At first glance, this would suggest that One Piece is actually knowledge, all the details of the true history one would desire to know. However, it's important to know that it's never necessarily been implied that everything in this world refers to the treasure itself. Roger simply stated that he left everything in this world at that place, on the final island, not that that was the treasure itself. That means that the final island possesses knowledge of everything in this world, but that in itself may or may not necessarily be the actual physical treasure, just something extra that is included there as Odin described it. However, as we'll soon see, this will prove to be a key clue to understanding the true nature of this treasure. So if you're new to this channel, then first, welcome! Please consider subscribing. But second, something we usually do in this channel is break down the Japanese version of One Piece and help explain a lot of linguistic details that often get lost in translation. And so, it's fitting that our second clue is a fact that Western fans are often unaware of. One Piece is technically not the full name of the treasure. You see, in written Japanese, there's something known as the phonetic reading and the kanji reading. Without going too much into complicated grammar, to put it as simply as possible, in manga, it's possible to write certain terms with two different readings, which allows certain words to have a double meaning. And believe it or not, the word One Piece is the same, as in many instances, while the word One Piece is written with that phonetic reading, the English words One Piece, it is also written with a kanji reading Hitotsunagi no Daihihō.
Hitotsunagi no Daihihō!
So, to break it down, Daihihō means great hidden treasure. What really matters to us is Hitotsunagi, because traditionally in Japanese, Hitotsunagi means something that is in a single piece. So the kanji reading would become the great hidden treasure in one piece. Relatively straightforward, right? Or so it would first seem. Because in reality, there's a glaring issue in the way that kanji reading is written, as Hitotsunagi is not written in kanji, but with its phonetic reading. Meaning, in simple terms, that we don't actually know what Hitotsunagi really actually means. Since Japanese is filled to the brim with homophones, it's often really hard to tell what a word means without the kanji reading, and in this case, we don't know what the real meaning of Hitotsunagi is because we lack its kanji and it has potential different readings. And thus, One Piece could refer to several different things. On one hand, there is the meaning we already mentioned, where Hitotsunagi can mean something in one piece. But another meaning can be if we separate the two words at a different syllable, as Hitotsunagi. Hito is the Japanese word for people, while tsunagi refers to something that connects. Specifically, it refers to something being tied, like the image of a rope. But it's also used with a metaphorical meaning to refer to the bonds that tie people together. After all, in Japanese folklore, it is believed that people are tied by strings, so this word is often used in anime and literature to represent one thing: connection. In other words, Hitotsunagi can mean that which connects people together. And it's in fact this very expression that one character uses in one of the most important scenes in the series to refer to a certain object we've seen before that reveals exactly to us what the One Piece is. But we'll get back to that later. Because we're not done yet, as Hitotsunagi can also mean one sea at peace. Specifically, nagi can mean a sea that is calm with no waves. This could tie into the idea we discussed of the red line and the grand line being destroyed, uniting all the seas into the all blue, and thus turning the world into one sea. And after the swell of an era arrives and the storm that the dew will bring takes place, the turbulent waters stirred by the storm will finally calm down and become at peace. And as such, the one sea at peace could refer to the all blue, a singular one sea that is united as one and that is finally at peace after a long and turbulent storm. What I'm getting at with this whole Hitotsunagi thing is that the Japanese reading for One Piece has multiple different meanings. And by extension, I think with this, Oda is trying to tell us that the word One Piece itself isn't limited to a single concept. I think it's more of an ideology that extends to several different things. Of course, don't get me wrong, there is the one physical treasure located at the final island, that much we know for a fact. But I think the word One Piece could also refer to other things beyond it. It could refer to the world unified as One Piece after it becomes the All Blue. It could even refer to the people themselves being united as One Piece, all living connected under the same sun, just like Joy Boy wanted. But beyond all that, I think that One Piece also refers to one more thing, to the laugh tale that Roger heard. And this is the most important clue of all, what is potentially the most important and iconic scene in the entire series. The moment when Roger finally arrived at the Laugh Tale. At that time when Roger stood in front of that enormous treasure, he laughed. And so did we. We laughed until tears came out of our eyes. And it's with this that Roger proclaimed, Joy Boy, what an unbelievable treasure you left behind. What a laugh tale. And this is kind of important, in fact. Roger found it so important that he decided to call the island itself Laugh Tale as a cheeky allusion to the story that he found there. Furthermore, this could be exactly what Odin referred to by everything in this world. The knowledge of the Void Sanctuary, all encompassed within a story. the story of Joy Boy's people. This would explain Roger's final words, because alongside the One Piece, he also left behind everything in this world, or in other words, a laugh tale that tells us about the truth of history, as indicated by the name he decided to give to the island. So I think that ultimately the All Blue, the idea of unifying the world, the laugh tale that tells of the White Century, and the physical treasure on the final island are all different things, even if they could all be referred to by the words One Piece. Could this story, this laugh tale, perhaps then be the key to everything we need to know? If we only had access to this story, then not only would it reveal everything that happened during the Void Century and give us answers to some of the biggest mysteries of the series, but it could outright even reveal what the One Piece itself is. If only Oda didn't hide it from us and we would be able to read it like Roger did, then we could finally find the answer to this mystery. This story would be our final key to solving the mystery of the One Piece. But unfortunately, we don't have access to this story, leaving this mystery forever unsolved.
One Piece is una foto de Oda.
Or do we? Because I would argue the complete opposite. I think that Oda has hid this story right under our noses somewhere in the manga, allowing us to actually access it, be able to read it, and discover all the secrets of the Void Century. But that only leaves the question, where did he hide it? How could he hide it? What is the laugh tale that Roger listened to? As we come to the climax of our journey, before I reveal to you the most fundamental clue in this puzzle,
I'd like to share a personal story
of how I came to find the One Piece myself. You see, there's something that I had always wanted to achieve for many years of my life. As someone with a long history of serious health issues, this is a dream that kept falling out of my reach. But finally, in 2019, I was finally able to achieve it. The dream to go to Japan. I went to live in Japan for 3 months in what I can only describe as one of the most incredible experiences of my life. But what matters to us is not that, but the fact that by sheer coincidence, or who knows, perhaps fate, my visit there just happened to line up with the release of a One Piece movie. But not just any One Piece movie, but One Piece Stampede, perhaps the most important film ever created for this series. For the first time in a One Piece film, Stampede was crammed to the brim with references and teases to the endgame of the story. And at the center of all that was the reveal that the final island we all thought was called Raftel was in fact Laugh-Tail. A whole 5 months before it was revealed in the actual manga, meaning that moviegoers who had the chance to watch this movie on release day, like me, were the first in the world to ever discover this unbelievable plot twist. But while some didn't think much of it, thinking it was just a weird romanization, when I first walked out of the theater on August 9th, 2019, I realized that this name, Laugh-Tail, had to be the key to everything. Because we had heard these words before in the story, the words Laugh-Tail, describing the story that tells us everything we need to know, the story that hides all the mysteries in the series, including the identity of the treasure itself. And that's when everything began to click in. When was it that we had heard of this laugh tale before? What is a story that details all the events of the Void Century? What is a story that had existed since the time Joy Boy was alive? What is a story that can be inherited just like inherited will? What is a story that every time it is heard, it always causes everyone to burst in laughter, just like the Roger Pirates did? And most importantly of all, what is a story that can be used at parties? A story that will be used in the world's biggest party to connect everyone in the world together.
El racismo. Sí, 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 sí.
¡Ja, mierda.
¡Oye, Brooke! ¿Cómo que lo sabes?
Parto la polla.
昔の海賊たちはみんなこれを歌ってました。辛い時も楽しい時も。
Me parto los cojones.
The laugh tale that Roger heard is, of course, none other than Binx's sake. The story of a joyous boy named Binx, and the story of his great kingdom. A story that every time it is sung, it always results in everyone laughing together. A story that is sung at parties to help connect people together. One that has been passed down this entire time right under our own eyes, just like it has been passed under the eyes of the world government, surviving across censorship and telling in secret the events of the Void Century, the truth of the world, in the form of a joyful song, of a laugh tale. This is a song that we even saw played across the entirety of Chapter 967, right before the Roger Pirates arrived at Laugh Tale. In that chapter, we see them sing part of the song, but for some reason, the final verses are missing. Is that perhaps because they are not missing, but are simply being played over the final scene as the Roger Pirates left? After all, even the anime played the song again right before memories kicked in. After all, the Japanese word for Laugh Tale, Warai Banashi, strictly refers to a story that has been passed down orally, not in the form of writing, so it makes sense that this tale exists in the form of a song. Not to mention, don't Crocus and Odin arm in arm look like they are dancing and singing? Just like we've seen others dance in the exact same pose when Binx's sake has been played? What else could the Roger Pirates have been doing in this scene but listening or singing to Binx's sake? Brooke mentioned that this song was sung in ancient times by pirates of those ancient eras, which would indicate that the song existed ever since the Void Century. Luffy even stated that Shanks and his crew often sang that song, and we even get to see a shot of them singing it in Chapter 1, which could indicate that the song did in fact appear from the very first chapter of the manga, but was simply left off screen. This would indicate that this song is something that Oda planned for a very long time, something we can actually prove, since Oda stated that he had Kohei Tanaka, the composer of the One Piece anime, make the tune several years before Thriller Bark even happened, going as far back as the early 2000s, shortly after One Piece started serializing. And Oda even stated that this is a song he hoped would go down in history, and one day be taught to future generations in schools across Japan. That's how important of a song it was to him. It's no doubt a song that is iconic to any One Piece fan, a song that I learned to memorize ever since I was a kid, even before I learned Japanese, one that many consider to be synonymous with the series. But it's not just this that points to the importance this song holds for the Void Century. Robin commented that this song was nostalgic to her. One might first assume she might have first heard it on a pirate crew while she was on the run, but you have to remember the word nostalgia, both in English and Japanese, refers strictly to fond memories. And the only even remotely fond memory Robin had were those at Ohara with the scholars, meaning that she must have heard that song from them, which undeniably links it with the research of the Void Century. Furthermore, we talked about how the Sea Kings mentioned that the whales would rejoice once Poseidon and Joy Boy would meet again, which would lead to the destruction of the Red Line, something that we've seen the whales attempting to do for so many years. This would suggest that the whales, which we've seen are far more intelligent than other animals, were, in a sense, allied with the wishes of the Sea Folk, as well as the people of the Great Kingdom. This would explain why when Brooke played Binx's sake to the whales at the entrance of the New World, they smiled and saw the Straw Hats as allies, helping them head to the new world. And in fact, that may be the reason why Laboon, lost from its family and separated from its pack, found a new family when he saw the Rumber Pirates. Because when they played Bing Sasaki in front of him, he recognized a tune that the other whales also sung. And with it, Laboon laughed. And that's perhaps the most telling clue to the importance of this song. Because every time it is played, it always results in laughter. It's a song that causes people to laugh when it is heard, because it is quite literally a laugh tale, a story that induces laughter. Whether it's the laughter of the little Laboon, to the laughing Roger Pirates, or the laughter it has induced in the many parties it has been played in, Bing Sasaki always causes laughter. It's a story that, as Brooke put it, is sung in times of sorrow, but also in times of joy. Because while it is a story that tells of a sad and harrowing event, of the eradication of Joy Boy's people and the long night that came after, beneath it all, it also has a spirit of hope, of a dawn that one day will come and bask the world in its light once more, bringing joy and laughter to all those that this song connects. That is why Joy Boy left behind this song, in order to help connect people together at parties so that the world would be united. Much like the Rumber Pirates, Joy Boy and his people likely passed away in tragic circumstances, and yet in their final moments they still sung, danced, smiled, and laughed, because they knew that even in such sorrow, their dreams would be inherited, and that was enough to bring them joy. It's this core idea of the dream of this massive party being inherited across the ages that is detailed in the story of Bing Sasaki. It's in the lyrics of this song that we are told the full history of the Great Kingdom, and more specifically, the story of the One Piece. Let's go to deliver Bing Sasaki. Let the sea breeze and the waves carry us. Beyond the tide, the sunset goes wild, a song of birds drawing circles to the sky. The first verse already tells us some very important information. For one, it mentions the sunset going wild, which refers to the sun setting after Joy Boy failed to unite the world together, which would lead to the Long Night, or in other words, the symbol of the rule of the world government, and later, the dawn of a new world. Similarly, Beyond the Tide could refer to the swell of an era, the expression of a new era that will come like a massive, unstoppable wave that has been used by several characters across the series, including by Roger in his final speech. This could also be inferred in the words wave, which refers once again to the swell of an era, or in other words, a tide, a wave, and sea breeze could represent wind or the coming of a storm, the storm that the D will bring with the swell of an era. Then there's also the line Wao Kakutori no Uta. This line is often translated as birds sing as they draw circles in the sky, but if translated more literally, it just means a song of birds drawn in circles to the sky. And what are birds drawn in circles? Why, of course, the Kozuki clan, whose mark is literally that of birds drawn in circles. And this song of theirs would refer to Bing Sasaki itself. Because after all, if it is the laugh tale that Roger read on the final island, then it is likely the Kozuki clan is the one that carved this song on poneglyphs in order to ensure that it would one day be passed down. The next verse mentions, "Goodbye, poor town, goodbye, my hometown. Singing with one dawn, a song of a ship sailing. Gold and silver waves too, they spray back into the blue. We are going to split the seas." This verse details having to say goodbye to a hometown. This could likely refer to the people of the Great Kingdom having to say goodbye to their hometown, the Great Kingdom itself, after it was lost to the world government. They have to say goodbye singing with one dawn, that song being, of course, Bing Sasaki itself, singing goodbye much like the Rumber Pirates had to say goodbye to their lives, hoping that their song would one day be inherited. The word Dawn refers to the sound effect that we've seen plastered across the entire series, though it could also refer to the word Dawn in English, referring of course to the Romans' Dawn. And the final line says, "We are going to split the seas." This expression, to split the seas, is the same that Odin used to refer to the war that would take place in the future, when the seas would literally be split, caused by the destruction of the Red Line and the Grand Line, splitting the seas and unifying them all into the old blue, with the mention of waves being repeated again to allude to the swell of an era. And this is reiterated once again in the following verse, stating that we pirates break the seas. The storm has come from a faraway sky. The waves are dancing, sound the drums. If you lose your nerve, this breath could be your last. There is no way tomorrow's morning sun won't rise. This verse directly mentions the all-important storm, the storm that the Dee will bring again, that will engulf the entire world, leading to the final conflict of the series. The waves are mentioned again, saying they will start dancing, stirred by the storm and the swell of an era. But at the same time, the song says to sound the drums. At first, one might make the mistake to think the drums indicate the arrival of war. But much like we saw in Skypiea, drums can also herald the arrival of a party, the party that would come after the storm. After all, there's no way tomorrow's morning sun won't rise, as the dawn of the world will certainly come. Let's go to deliver Binx's sake. It'll happen one day, the evening dream. A shadow waving by that I will never meet again. But what are you brooding for? Tomorrow the night moon will still be there. This verse is about describing the concept of inherited will that we talked about in a previous episode. People only die when they are forgotten, but that means that as long as people's dreams are remembered, they will never die, and thus, people's dreams will never end. In this case, the evening dream, or in other words, the dream right before the sunset, the arrival of the night, the dream of Joy Boy's people of one day ushering in a new dawn, will happen one day. A shadow that we will never meet again waves us goodbye. The shadow representing those who we've lost, those who died and have remained behind, us unable to ever meet them again. However, what are you brooding for? What need is there to be sad? As tomorrow, or in other words, once a new morning comes and the dawn takes place, the night moon will still be there. As we mentioned before, the night moon is a term used in Toki's poem during her final words, one that in that context represented Odin himself, but it's a term that also refers to all those that have passed away. We saw Ace similarly being referred to as a night moon, as it represents those who have passed away before the dawn came. But as the song mentions, the night moon, or those who have died, will still be there once the tomorrow and the dawn come, because those people will live on as long as we remember them. As we've been told so many times across the series, the dawn will shine even in the world beyond, and its light will be delivered to even those who have left us behind. And this is once again reminded to us in the final verse, where not only is the one sea, the all blue, mentioned once again, but so is the idea that no matter who you are, we all end up as bones. Because in the end, we all die. But that is fine, because as long as we are remembered, even if we end up as bones, we will always live on. And finally, the song closes off with the iconic words that Roger used to describe the story he listened to on that final island. Let's go to deliver Binx's sake. Let's sing with one dawn a song of a sea. It doesn't matter who you are, we all end up as bones. A never-ending, ever-wandering laugh tale. Binx's sake is this laugh tale. It says it in the lyrics directly. It's a laugh tale that tells us everything in the world, what happened to Joy Boy's people, and what his hopes were for what would happen in the future when someone would find the One Piece. If we decode them and summarize them, the song's lyrics tell us the full story. Let's go to the liver being Sasaki. The sun is setting and our kingdom is coming to an end, but this song will be preserved by the Kozuki clan. We must say goodbye to our hometown. However, one day, we are going to split the seas by destroying the Red Line and the Grand Line. The storm of the deep will come, as will the swell of an era. But there's no way, the dawn won't come and the sun won't rise. Our dream before the sunset will happen one day. Those who have left us behind, wave us
literalmente goda.
But why be sad? Because those who have died will still be there tomorrow when the sun rises. Let's sing about one dawn, a song of the all blue. Because even if we die, we'll all live on as long as our dreams are remembered. Just like this never-ending, ever-wandering laugh tale. Yo-ho-ho-ho, yo-ho-ho-ho. Yo-ho-ho-ho.
El verdadero One Piece.
Yo-ho-ho-ho.
Yo-ho-ho-ho-ho-ho-ho.
The song concludes with a loud and joyful laughter. The chorus of the song is literally laughter. Yo-ho-ho-ho, the laughter that is always so commonly associated with pirates. Because this is a laugh tale that always brings laugh and makes people laugh as they sing it. It details the story of the Great Kingdom, its eventual fate, but also the survival of its people by living through being remembered. This tale reveals us all the mysteries in this story. But if so, one question remains. Does it also reveal what the One Piece is?
Sinceramente, cuando he empezado todo el tema de la canción y he empezado los primeros versos, es en plan, buah, estás rebuscando esto a un nivel espectacular. Pero la verdad es que conforme vas adelante y dando ejemplos de que utiliza literalmente los mismos kanjis y las mismas, sabes, las mismas sílabas en plan japonés y tal para la canción que para el momento de Laugh Tale, para el momento de Y se rió, es como madre. Además, todo el tema de las olas doradas y las olas plateadas que se unirán en toda una azul tal, es como... Sí, todo eso son suposiciones, obviamente, pero hay muchas cosas que tienen muchísimo sentido. Ya no porque le encuentre justificación dentro de la obra, porque puede ser simplemente una paja suya y que no tenga nada que ver para el desarrollo general. Pero, no sé, tiene mucho sentido sobre todo el tema de unir, ¿sabes? En plan, de quitar las limitaciones y quitar las diferencias, que todos estemos bajo un mismo sol, ¿sabes? Que toda la libertad y que todo lo que se desea al final es una gran fiesta, porque realmente es algo que en todos los arcos de One Piece, al terminar, es como la gran fiesta, la gran risa, el celebrar que hemos pasado por todo esto. No sé.
Of course it does. In fact, it states it time and time again through the entire song to the point that...
One Piece, dime.
If you've been paying attention, you might have realized yourself already all this time, since the very start. The One Piece, which has been there right under our own eyes ever since Chapter 1 and across the entire series, has its identity revealed in this laugh tale. It's something that has connected Luffy since the very beginning all the way up until the end, the one thing capable of connecting everyone together as one, something which will finally connect and unify the entire world in the world's biggest party as One Piece, just like it forged Luffy's very first
El plan de Fernando Alonso. Es una botellita de sake. El Bin Sake.
Oda es un alcohólico.
Is sake itself. The physical treasure waiting at the end of the seas on the island of Laugh-Tail is sake itself. Binks' sake. Ace himself said it better than anyone else. Right before exchanging sake cups with Luffy and Sabo, using the exact same word, tsunagu, that exists in Hitotsunagi, he's literally telling us that sake is something that connects people together. Sake connects people as one. It literally makes us one piece. Like a lot of elements in One Piece, this is something that ties a lot with Japanese culture and the customs that come with sake.
Si resulta...
Far more than in...
Si resulta ser esto... Literalmente aparece, vamos, noticia mundial, 20 millones de noticias, One Piece incita al alcoholismo.
Most other countries. In Japan, sake has a lot of cultural importance, as drinking is considered something that connects people together. Hito Tsunagi. It's a moment when the strict social boundaries of Japanese society can be thrown away and people can celebrate together as equals, and as such, it is considered very common to go out drinking with others to have a good time. And of course, what is it that happens when you drink a lot? Well, you start laughing. Sake is something that brings people together and allows them to party hand in hand, resulting in a lot of...
Para no reír, ¿sabes? O sea, eres el puto Roger, llegas hasta el puto final y dices, venga, va, dame la verdad. Y tienes una botellita de Baileys que te dice... y una nota. Disfruta, man. Y un emoji así. Dale duro. A esta invito yo. Después de tantos años, que hace mucho que no nos vemos.
Joy and laughter, just like we have seen.
Te partes el puto culo, es que te partes el puto culo.
Again.
No hay más.
Furthermore, in Japan, it is custom to offer sake to the deceased, which ties with the idea that the One Piece is something that will reach even those who have passed away and were not able to be present there to witness it.
Eso es verdad.
So even if they have died, the One Piece and the dawn of the world will still be delivered to them, even in the world beyond.
¿Qué es muere?
The lyrics of Binks' sake makes very clear. But I don't need to tell you the importance of sake in Japanese culture, because even the manga itself does a great job at already explaining its importance in canon. Just like in Japan, the exchange of sake cups is meant to be a sign of brotherhood, of family. It's a ritual that allows those who are not tied by blood to become like family. We saw this with Luffy, Ace and Sabo becoming brothers, as well as Luffy exchanging sake every time a new crew member joined his crew to form a bond of friendship with them, a bond stronger than blood, stronger than anything else, that will ensure that they remain friends forever. A bond of nakama. And thus, at the final island at the ends of the seas, lies one piece of sake that will allow Luffy to connect with so many more than just his crew, but with people from all over the world. Luffy will finally be able to make
te me cuidas,
the biggest party in the world a reality.
Botellita de Jagger.
And bring everybody
Let's
together
go.
To live under the same sun. Roger was too early because the ancient weapons had not been...
¿Te imaginas que durante todo este tiempo lleva literalmente 20 años escribiendo esto y es un puto anuncio publicitario? Que le ha patrocinado, yo qué sé, Baileys, JB, una marca de whisky, lo que sea, de sake que flipas, Coca-Cola. De repente, uf, después de tantos años, una historia tan increíblemente legendaria, en plan, recuerda, mejor manga de todos los tiempos, bla, 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 llegan literalmente, hostia, Dios, madre, una marca de ron, por eso lo de los piratas, llega literalmente una marca de ron, Barceló, y hace Luffy, mira, un tesoro, puta madre. Lo abre y a cámara, de repente, Ron Barceló está riquísimo. Y un link a comprar. Un QR. Con un QR, una nota y en la nota hay un QR para ir a la web a comprar. ¡Buah! Alucina, chaval. Alucina. Alucina, chaval. El mejor... ¡Buah! ¡Buah! La mejor publicidad de la historia. De la historia. Millones y millones de Barceló invertidos en Eiichiro Oda. Millones para que creara todo esto alrededor del anuncio. Buah. Eso sí que tiene sentido, ¿ves? Eso sí que tiene sentido. Buah. Alucinas.
Born yet, and so the Red Line of the Grand Line could not be destroyed to unify the world into the old blue. Because of that, the people of the world still remained segregated. The world government still held its iron grip over the
es
world.
El logo de Ron Manzano.
And thus, it would be
mundo.
Impossible to bring people from all over the world to throw the world's biggest party. But once that is achieved, once a new Joyboy appears to guide the ancient weapons, just like Otohime foretold, then finally the original Joyboy's treasure, the sake he brewed while waiting for Luffy, will finally be put to use to connect the entire world together in one massive party. In the end, One Piece is a story about pirates, so what better treasure is there for pirates than a bottle of booze, just like all the pirate stories of old? In that regard, there really is no more fitting treasure to bring the series to such a climactic culmination than sake. But One Piece being sake is something that is far more fitting beyond even everything we've mentioned so far. Because just like I stated, the One Piece has been hidden under our eyes this entire time, ever since the very beginning, ever since chapter 1. In the very first chapter of the series, right after the beginning, most of the chapter took place inside a bar literally called Parties, may I remind you, where we saw the red-haired pirates partying and exchanging sake. Something that inspired Luffy enough to awaken in him the dream to throw the biggest party in the world. The exact same dream that Roger had mentioned so many years prior. But even more important than that is the scene that followed after. The one that set up the entire conflict and the core theme for the starting chapter of this series. The party of the pirates was suddenly interrupted by a band of bandits. And what is it that Shanks did in that occasion? He offered Higuma a bottle of sake. In chapter 1, since the very start of the series, we saw Shanks offering the equivalent of the One Piece to Higuma as a way to offer a bond of friendship. Higuma, however, rejected the bottle of sake, smashing it in Shanks' face because he refuses to exchange sake. He wants all the sake for himself. But in face of that, what did Shanks do? He laughed. Because Shanks knows how foolish it is to want to monopolize something like that. Sake should be shared, it should be used to help connect people together, to laugh together. Ever since the very start, Oda established this fundamental theme about the identity of the One Piece. And it's this core theme that ties together, that connects together, the entire series. But it doesn't stop just there, because across the entire series, across some of the most iconic and memorable scenes of the story, we see sake right under our eyes again and again. After Luffy witnessed the incident with Shanks and then proclaimed his dream in front of Ace and Sabo, what did Ace do? He exchanged sake between the three of them to connect them in a bond of brotherhood, laying the first step to Luffy's dream. One that would one day be accomplished by exchanging sake with people from all over the world. Then, in chapter 100, when the Straw Hats enter the Grand Line, they declare their vows to reach their dreams. And where did they do it? Over a barrel of sake, a scene that is also later paralleled in the anime. At Drum Island, when Hiruluk bid his farewell and explained to us just what exactly Inherited Will is, that people die when they are forgotten, what is it that he did with his final action? He drank a cup of sake. And Kureha also drank from a bottle of sake as a sign that she would inherit his will. When Bellamy mocked Luffy at Jaya saying that the One Piece doesn't exist, he stated that fools never notice the real treasure around them, surrounded by so many bottles of sake. And as Luffy and the others left the bar, Blackbeard laughed in the face of Bellamy, claiming that dreams are real, that dreams never end, and that the One Piece does, in fact, exist, as he slammed down to the ground a bottle of sake, symbolizing the existence.
¡Goda lo hizo de nuevo! Oh.
Tiene todo el sentido del mundo, la verdad. O sea, quitando la broma, tiene todo el sentido del mundo. También os digo, sigo manteniendo que si realmente es esto, a ver, los típicos medios, la típica movida de retrasados mentales y el debate de la incitación al alcoholismo. Que es un, yo qué sé, es un debate que va a estar ahí, simplemente a lo muestro no mirar, jiji, jaja, pero es algo que va a estar. Pero tiene todo el sentido del mundo, la verdad, tiene todo el sentido del mundo. Y cuanto más me va contando, más sentido tiene. Y es que es algo que te, es que es eso, quitando la broma que hemos hecho antes, es algo que te haría partir el culo. Llegar un poco hasta el tesoro definitivo, lo abres y es una botellita de sake, en plan, ole, a disfrutar mi rey. Yo me partiría el puto culo.
Of the One Piece. During the flashback in Skypiea, we saw Nolan and Calgara being able to bond together through sake,
connecting
the two of them
ya.
together despite being so different. Something that would later be recalled at the big party at the end of the arc where everybody gets to exchange sake together as they laugh. At Sabaody, when Rayleigh talked about Roger's death, he said that on that day, he had never laughed more, he had never cried more, and he had never drank more sake either. Just like on the day that the Roger pirates found the treasure. In order to honor the death of his captain, in hope that someone would one day inherit his will. And afterwards, when Luffy lost his crew, all he could think back at, in that moment of sorrow, was them parting together and exchanging sake with each other, as Binks' sake plays in the background of that scene. Then, when Whitebeard declared his final words right before that moment, he thought back at a time when he and Roger exchanged sake together, only to then proclaim that the One Piece does in fact exist. At the end of Dressrosa, when the Grand Fleet was formed, just like Luffy did with Ace and Sabo, several pirates,
chaval,
all from different races,
sentido,
decided
verdad,
to exchange sake with Luffy.
Poca broma, tiene todo el sentido, en verdad,
Because he doesn't want to exchange sake to be their boss. He wants to exchange sake to be equals with them, something he did after through the act of a massive party. In Whole Cake Island, Luffy said that he could not become the Pirate King without Sanji. But think about it, is it a coincidence?
¿Estás diciendo que la verdadera felicidad viene de ser un alcohólico? Ese es el verdadero One Piece, ¿verdad? Claro, tiene el sentido, en verdad, ¿eh? Ah, es que ahora todo tiene sentido. Claro.
Since then, Luffy always insisted that he wanted a cook and a musician for his crew. Someone who could cook and serve sake at his party at the end of the series, and someone who could play Binks' sake to help connect everybody there together. Then things get big once we reach chapter 967. Of course, we've talked about the Roger Pirates literally singing Binks' sake before reaching the final island. And even after that scene, we see it once again. Right after the Roger Pirates left Laugh Tale, they are all drinking sake, and Rayleigh and Roger once again exchange a bottle of sake. Later, in Odin's execution, right as he died, he mentioned that even if some were to forget him, he wouldn't mind because there will be others, specifically his scabbards, who will remember him and his dream, and thus he would live on. And after saying that, Odin stated, "If I am meant to be something to accompany one piece of sake, then that suits me fine." Odin is literally describing himself as something that accompanies one piece of sake, because Odin is something that is often eaten alongside sake. So Odin views himself as something that accompanies the sake that is One Piece. And of course, in the end, there's the scene of Yamato and Ace exchanging sake as they talk about Luffy's dream, which leads into the full title of chapter 1000. In the context of that chapter, it's Yamato who's talking in that title, someone who had been waiting so long for Luffy to arrive. But what if in the larger scope of things, the one talking is meant to be Joy Boy, referring exactly to just that. One Piece, the sake I brewed while waiting for you, Straw Hat Luffy. These are but a few examples I can put of how the One Piece has been hidden right under our eyes the whole time. But if you go back, you'll notice so many instances of how important sake is to the series and how it ties with the themes of laughter, partying, and connection. This is of course not even accounting all the countless parties where we've seen everybody indulging in joy and laughter all across the series. Oda has kept the One Piece hidden right under our noses, yet at the same time doing it so subtly that no one ever realized consciously. In the end, at last, we can finally understand why the title of this series is so important, because it literally connects and brings everyone together as one. Everyone becomes One Piece. The words One Piece mean much more than just one thing. On one hand, it refers to the world when it will be unified as the Old Blue after the Red Line and the Grand Line are destroyed, literally becoming one piece of a planet. On the other, it also refers to the laugh tale that has been inherited across the ages, the song being Sasaki, which is quite literally one piece of music. And of course, it refers to the treasure that lies on the final island, being one piece of sake, one that represents a way to unite and connect the entire world together. But in the end, One Piece refers to a much simpler concept. Ourselves, the readers. That we can all come together and become One Piece. Through the world, through this love deal, and through sake, we can all be connected together and party hand in hand, to throw away war and hatred, and instead indulge in joy and laughter. What point is there to war, to hatred, sorrow, and suffering? Why rob away the freedom from other people when you could simply share your joy together with them? Just like sake, life is meant to be shared with others. It is meant to connect us together. Rather than waste our time in conflict and getting angry with each other, we should just party and laugh together. It's such a simplistic message, a childish one even, but it's such a pure message that fully encapsulates the ideals that Oda has been trying to tell us this entire time. One Piece refers to much more than just a treasure, a laugh tale, or the world itself. It refers to all of us readers. Those of us who, thanks to One Piece, we have come together to become as One Piece ourselves. Gracias. Because what else is it that connects us together but One Piece? As in, the actual manga. In the end, One Piece itself is basically our own One Piece, because it brings us all together. No matter our races, no matter our nationalities, no matter our beliefs, no matter who we are, we are all connected together in this incredible story. Eiichiro Oda has managed to make it impossible and has connected together so many people all across the world, forging friendships, relationships, and connections, bonds of nakama that bring us all together as one piece. So in that regard, the series could not have a more fitting title, because thanks to it, we all are One Piece. And it is specifically in the manga itself that we finally realize how the answer had been right on our noses this whole entire time. From the very beginning, even before Chapter 1, from the second that someone picks up the series, the answer is right in front of their eyes. On the cover of Volume 1, we see a large expanse of sea. In it sits a lone island, an island that looks exactly identical to all the depictions we've seen of the All Blue, always drawn with this exact same island, with this precise shape and this exact palm tree. Its presence in this cover symbolizes the All Blue that will be created at the end of the series. But more importantly, on the foreground, we have the Straw Hats partying, singing, and dancing together. And among them, we see Zoro laying on a chest of treasure, which symbolizes the treasure, the One Piece itself. And what does Zoro do? He laughs. While he holds in his hand, at the center of the cover, a bottle of sake. The One Piece.
O sea, 1 hora y 3 minutos para decirme que es la amistad que nos une a todos. ya hablando en serio, este vídeo es Jesucristo. O sea, este vídeo es Jesucristo. O sea, 1 hora de pura magia, la verdad. Tiene todo el sentido del mundo. Igual luego no lo es, porque yo qué sé, igual lo... ¿Sabes? Lo lleva por otros caminos, o es otra lectura, o el One Piece en sí mismo, lo que es físicamente, es otra cosa, pero tiene todo el puto sentido del mundo, la verdad. Por la importancia que tiene por la historia, por cómo une a los demás, por el cómo se ofrece sake también a los muertos, en plan, la cultura de Japón es algo como muy, muy extendido. Y que no sea simplemente una cosa, ¿sabes? Algo como físico, quitando más allá del sake, que es algo que te puede hacer partir el culo, sino sobre todo lo que a mí más me cuadra, por decirlo de alguna manera, lo que creo que tiene en plan todo el puto sentido del mundo, y raro es que no fuera así, es el tema de unir todos los mares, de que esas armas tan importantes sean acabar literalmente con esas limitaciones y que todo el mundo se pueda llegar a unir y todo el mundo pueda llegar a estar bajo el mismo sol, por decirlo de alguna manera, en igualdad de condiciones, dejando a un lado el racismo. Y no sé, sinceramente, ha sido una hora de puro disfrute. Tiene todo el sentido del mundo. Ya os digo, hay algunas cosas que igual me parecen un poquito más enrevesadas que otras, buscándole alguna explicación que, bueno, sabes, jugando con el significado de las palabras, acaba encajando un poco en la idea que tú mismo puedes llegar a tener. Pero quiero decir, es una teoría. Evidentemente, te aferras a esos pequeños detalles para poder construir un poco la idea que tienes en la mente, aparte de respaldarlo con muchísimas cosas que pasan durante toda la serie y que tienen todo el sentido del mundo. No tengo ningún pero más allá de eso. Ha sido una hora donde todo ha cobrado muchísimo sentido, donde el siglo vacío que yo no paraba de darle vueltas a qué cojones tienen que ocultar, qué cojones pasó en esos 100 años que sea tan importante en la obra y por qué quieren ocultarlo tantísimo, tiene todo el putísimo sentido del mundo que el gobierno mundial no quiera que acaben con el sistema que está impuesto ahora mismo y del cual se benefician y del cual viven, ¿sabes? O sea, no quieren que esa voluntad de yo y voy pase más allá de eso y se vuelva a revivir. Y también que el sake de Bing sea una especie de no sé, de carta, por decirlo de alguna manera, de mensaje que se perpetúa y que está siempre delante de tu puta cara, pero que es como un código, como la capoeira. El sake de Bing es como la capoeira de la peña de los esclavos que no podían practicar artes marciales, pero se inventaban como una especie de baile. Literalmente es la capoeira. Sobre todo que te haga reír, porque es que es lo que digo, o sea, me parece increíblemente cómico y me reiría de igual forma si después de toda la puta aventura increíble y después de tanto putísimo misterio llegue y dentro del cofre del tesoro haya una botella de ron Barceló y que me diga, bro, a mi salud, crack, ¿sabes? Sería como, pero hijo de la gran puta. Es maravilloso, la verdad. O sea, ya os digo, puede que no sea así y puede que haya detalles que cambien, puede que haya cosas que es eso, que simplemente te agarras como a pequeños detalles, como el tema, el último mensaje de la isla que siempre se nos representa de igual manera, con una palmerita y que eso demuestra que todo el mar realmente está unido, pues bueno, ya puede ser eso, puede ser que, ¿sabes? En plan, Oda viendo esta teoría, toda la puta ida de olla que se montan, y Oda pensando, man, es una islita que me quedaba bien en todos los sitios porque es sencilla.
¡Goda lo hizo de nuevo!
Muchísimas gracias a todos, ha sido un directo, la verdad, muy especial, que me lo he pasado de putísima madre, hemos charlado genial, hemos hecho lo de Rebue, que se ha unido aquí la comunidad, se ha unido con, no con sake, pero se ha unido aquí toda la comunidad para que esto llegara a suceder. Hasta luego, caballeros, te cuido.